Hi friends, welcome back to another episode of Generation Tech. My name is Alan. We recently talked about how clones viewed the Clone Wars as it progressed. Today we'll be looking at the other side of the war, the Confederacy of Independent Systems, or the so-called bad guys in the Clone Wars series, which means their point of view is rarely ever shown. There's actually a lot more going on within the Confederacy than Count Dooku and his faceless legions of evil droids. There are thousands of worlds full of sentient beings with a million different opinions, needs, and grievances. Today we're going to be taking a look at this forgotten side of the war and figure out just what all the civilians on these Separatist worlds were thinking when the Clone Wars was going on.
The Confederacy was in many ways just like the Republic. It was made of numerous sovereign planets and systems that united in a loose federation.
Their government had a legislative branch and executive branch, and most likely a judicial branch that we don't really get to see as well. The Separatist Senate had representatives from all of its worlds. This was one of the sign-up bonuses that the Confederacy of Independent Systems was offering. You see, the Republic, being as old as it was, had all sorts of different levels of memberships, kind of like Netflix. While most of the core worlds and inner rim planets had been with the Republic for millennia and had representation and memberships, most of the outer rim planets did not, which meant taxation without representation. Also, after the Rusan Reformation, the Senate was further condensed to make the legislative process smoother. This meant that a region of space that was formerly represented by 10 senators would now be represented by one. So the Confederacy of Independent Systems made sure that each planet had one representative, and that was kind of easy to do because this was, after all, a new government and a relatively small government when compared to the Republic's millions of worlds. And just like in the Republic, the Separatists had many varying viewpoints. And although they were united against the Republic in their own war of independence, the Separatist Parliament had three major factions: war, peace, and independence. The war faction supported extending and escalating the war against the Galactic Republic. Hardliners in the war faction believed that the Republic needed to be destroyed for there to be peace in the CIS. It was said many of the senators who joined this faction also represented worlds that were heavily involved in the military-industrial complex. Voatol was one of the leaders of this faction, and she was staunchly opposed to the Peace Faction. The Peace Faction was headed by individuals like Mina Bonteri, who wanted to end the fighting on moral grounds. Although the media was heavily controlled and filtered in Separatist territory, many people were beginning to question the conduct of the droid army in the field. The Peace Faction was also against the wartime powers that had been given to Count Dooku, just like many individuals in the Republic Senate were opposed to Palpatine's attempts to grab more power for the executive branch. It comes as no surprise that individuals like Mina and Padme Amidala were close friends from their days in the Republic Senate and maintained ties even as the war split their people apart. Then we had the Independence Faction, which was clearly aware of the war crimes that the Separatist Droid Army was committing, but instead of just wanting peace, they wanted to get out of the CIS and become a neutral faction, which wasn't involved in the war at all. It's possible that such an organization could even join the Council of Neutral Systems, led by the true Mandalorians in the Republic. So, as you can see, the CIS, just like the Republic, were full of all sorts of different people with different agendas. The head of state would be Count Dooku, and he would serve as the executive branch of the Confederacy. He was kind of vilified by the Republic's civilian populace and media. People saw him as a traitor to the Jedi Order and a warmonger. And some people even accused him of being an evil space wizard. But of course, just like the Confederacy of Independent Systems, the Republic was full of its own propaganda as well. While not as restrictive as the CIS, the Republic media environment had pretty much agreed to label Dooku as an evil villain, and no one was really willing to step out of line. But to the Separatist Alliance, Count Dooku was seen in a very different light. He was kind of like this celebrity politician and thought leader. While there has always been dissent amongst the Outer Rim colonies, it wasn't until Count Dooku arrived to the scene that someone was able to unify all those people into one organized group. Several years after leaving the Jedi Order, Count Dooku emerged out of isolation and delivered an epic speech on the Republic Holonet from the Raxus system. He outlined many of the problems with the Republic, specifically focusing on their corruption and mistreatment of the Outer Rim territories. Not only were many Outer Rim territories not given representation in the Senate, many of them were still paying taxes and not even receiving basic support from the Republic. As we've mentioned many times on this channel, the Republic was basically demilitarized at this point in time, so the Outer Rim colonies were left on their own. Worlds that couldn't defend themselves had some pretty terrible choices: either let a corporation defend their local territory in exchange for their autonomy and freedom, or they could try their luck with one of the less violent criminal organizations and pay for protection. Of course, none of these options were really all that reliable, and many of these colonies would just get destroyed or disappear. The freedom to go about your lives without worrying about getting hacked to death by some pirates is the most basic thing a government should provide to its people. And the Republic, by all accounts, was failing miserably. The Outer Rim really needed economic support, infrastructure upgrades, and security forces. The Republic had basically cut a deal with major corporate groups to turn the entire region into a free trade zone to increase investment in the area. And for a while, some positive change did occur, but soon organizations like the Trade Federation treated the Outer Rim like their own personal fiefdoms and treated the citizens living out there like indentured servants and corporate slaves. But of course, when organizations like the Trade Federation started turning a profit in the Outer Rim, the Republic removed this free trade zone, and that really pissed them off and led to the Naboo blockade crisis. And the reality was, for a lot of the civilians living out in the Outer Rim, the Republic was really never in the picture. Depending on where you lived, you probably never saw any official or worker from the Republic at all. And so these individuals didn't actually feel like they belonged to the Republic or owed it anything. As a matter of fact, for most of history, these forgotten worlds in the Outer Rim were pretty much just exploited by whatever large power was in the area, whether it's the Sith Empire, the Galactic Republic, Trade Federation, First Order. These Outer Rim territories basically had it the worst in the entire galaxy. And so Count Dooku would continue his speaking tour around the Outer Rim on planets like Ryloth or his own homeworld of Serrano and other worlds that were dissatisfied with the status quo. He started drawing larger and larger crowds. To the people in the Outer Rim, it was a real big deal that someone like Count Dooku was speaking out for them. Dooku was not only from a noble family, he was also an ex-Jedi. More importantly, Dooku could leverage his experience from working with the Senate as a Jedi and talk about just how corrupt and inefficient the entire system was. He confirmed that the core world politicians rarely ever thought about the planets in the Outer Rim, and the people loved him for that and soaked up every word he said. No one who ever mattered had ever spoken out for them or advocated their cause. Dooku was a rock star, and they would follow him to the edge of the galaxy if he asked them to. When the secessionist movement started, many in the CIS felt like their demands were reasonable. If we look at their Senate, for instance, only one of the factions really wanted open war with the Republic. Most separatists just wanted a peaceful separation. But when the Battle of Geonosis happened, a lot of Outer Rim folks saw this as an aggressive attack by the Republic against the legal Trade Federation army. The separatists saw this as a direct breach of their rights as sovereign planets to defend themselves. And it was also strange that the Republic just somehow produced an army of clones from nowhere. The clone army really terrified the average Confederate citizen. They were extremely efficient at their job and probably amongst the best trained soldiers in the galaxy. Combined with their full body armor and helmets, and they probably looked more like droids than humans. Count Dooku had elected to use droids for his war because he didn't want separatist civilians to get harmed in the conflict, a very noble gesture that further endeared him to his constituents. But many planetary defense forces and local defense forces were still made out of organic troops, and sometimes they had to go up against the Grand Army of the Republic. Of course, a lot of times the fighting broke out on planets before even the Separatists and Republic troops arrived. Once the Clone Wars started overnight, thousands of civil wars started erupting all across the galaxy, usually the result of thousands of years of competition and grudges. Pro-Separatist factions would battle it out against what they saw as corrupt pro-Republic factions. And when the Clone Army eventually arrived, they were just as ruthless as any other army in galactic history. And so the Separatist civilian populace grew to hate and fear the Clone Army. The clones' dedication to their duty and order was really a dedication to killing their people. Separatist philosophers and thought leaders would have most likely abhorred the idea of using sentient human clones in order to fight in a war. It would have rightly been labeled as slavery. Of course, most nations at war will only point out the moral deficiencies of their enemy and completely ignore its own abuses. And as we mentioned, the Separatists had a very good control of information flowing off the battlefield. Because most Separatist fleets and ground forces were completely automated and obedient, there were no pesky, morally righteous individuals that would become whistleblowers and cry out about Separatist war crimes. So a lot of Separatist civilians were basically shielded from all of the atrocities and war crimes being committed by their army. Now, obviously there was news coming in from the Republic, but would you trust information coming from an enemy you're fighting a war against? Do we look at Russia today as a reliable source of information? So that means that the average civilian in the Separatist alliance was not evil. They probably weren't even violent. They probably didn't even want war. All they really cared about was making their own lives better, which is 99% of what drives the world today. And if you look at life on many of these Outer Rim worlds, it had almost become unbearable to live there. From the Rusan Reformation until the Clone Wars, there was but one choice for governance in the galaxy, and that was the Republic. And the Republic was way too large for any small Outer Rim planet to fight against. So the creation of the Confederacy of Independent Systems finally united all of those lone voices out there. And although at the end of the day, the CIS was created by the very Republic it was fighting, many planets and systems joined because of real grievances they had with the Republic. In war and conflict, oftentimes one side will basically dehumanize the other side and just label them as the enemy. This is a really great tool to convince your people to kill their people. But as we know nowadays, that's oftentimes not the reality of the situation. People are just people no matter where you go. And, you know, we believe in humanity first, and we think it's really important to always look at people as an individual. So guys, I hope you enjoyed today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and hit that notification button so you don't miss out on the rest of our awesome content. And as usual, thanks for joining us today. If you're watching this, you are Generation Tech. You are Generation Tech? You are Generation Tech.